My beginnings of the Tales series started since 2009 with Tales of Vesperia, and then on the same year, I brought Tales of Symphonia and its sequel Dawn of the New World at Christmas. The last mainline Tales game I played was Tales of Berseria, which was a great game, although I had 4 issues of this game. While the story and characters of the game were superb, the ending was disappointing and anticlimactic, a la Batman Arkham Knight, bland level design, mediocre boss selection, and forgettable soundtrack with several great songs. Now, 1 week before or after the game's release in America and Europe, Namco Bandai announced there is a Tales game in the works for Nintendo Switch, which was revealed at E3 2018 as Tales of Vesperia, not only for Nintendo Switch, but also for PC, PS4, and Xbox One, and the version was based on not Xbox 360 version, but the Japanese exclusive PlayStation 3 version. Now, was the definitive edition worth a second purchase from me who played the first version back in 2009? But let's jump into the world of Terca Lumeres of Vesperia. I did do a vlog of this game almost a decade ago, and it hasn't aged well and it sucks, as well as my favorite videos, so I'm doing justice for those videos, so let's get started. So the story starts off with someone stole the Aqua Blastia from Lower Quarter's fountain at Zophius, which Yirilowel, the main protagonist, is going for a quest along with his trusty dog Rabid and the Princess of the Empire Estelle. During their quest, they meet other party members like Carol, a former member of the Monster Hunter Guild Hunting Blade, Rita, a hot-headed mage, Raven, a shady archer with a backstory that I won't spoil, and Judith, a female Kritian dragoon with a whale-looking entelechia called Baul. The Definitive Edition and PS3 version adds 2 more party members for more story interactions. There are Flynn, Yuri's childhood friend and Imperial Knight, who was a temporary party member in the Xbox 360 version, and the pirate girl Patty Fleur, who is looking for a treasure called Maristella and has amnesia. The story is more than just recovering the Blastia, but also the background of the Empire, guilds, Entelechia, and in the Definitive and PS3 version about Ifrid, who has no relation to Von Ifrid from Berseria, and the game's lore, tone, and themes kept me hooked. Speaking of which, Definitive Edition and PS3 version adds not only Patty and Flynn for existing cutscenes, but also new cutscenes as well. There are also some alterations for the story progression. For example, in the 360 version, the party approaches the building where Barbaros is hiding in Dawngrest at the front door. But in the Definitive Edition and PS3 version, it's guarded by his men, so Raven shows a hidden path from the tavern via sewer. Another one is the way to get to Miorzo, where you get the bell from a Kritian at Aspio. However, the bell in the Definitive Edition and PS3 version is in a cave located in Hypionia continent with red flowers. Also, there is one moment in Definitive Edition and PS3 version, which I'll talk about it on October. Now, this game has my favorite party members like Yuri, which has a great sense of humor, and he's a protagonist who can tell from right and wrong. Rabid is unique for being an animal companion that is playable, and I like him. Estelle is cute, but she is such a bookworm, and sometimes as an archaeologist. Carol, while he's expert on monsters for the most part, he has some awesome moments where he's toughing up for something, and not the stupid naming things, except the guild named Brave Vesperia. Rita is a character that I have a love-hate relationship, but she is competent mage of Aspio, especially being smartass. Also, for some reason, Rabid must have some sort of grudge on Rita, perhaps Rita being a cat person and her jealousy towards Rabid. Raven, while he's a stupid pervy old man, I do like him how much he knows of the Empire and the Guild. Judith is a stunning character. Not only she is a pretty face and my favorite female characters in the series, but she is such a level-headed character and she is like a big sister of the group. Now for Flynn and Patty. Flynn can be somewhat of a boy scout and do butt heads with Yuri sometimes, but he still considers him a friend, and sometime in the second and third act, he forms with Patty an interesting friendship. Now speaking of Patty, let's talk about her. Patty is not just cute, but her recovering her memories is similar to System Shock 2 and Doom 2016, and my favorite moment is her realization of her having friends around at Egothor Forest, which is rather heartwarming and awesome. Also, she sometimes gets between Yuri and someone like Flynn, for example, as they stand in their way. She is also the funniest character in the game, and I love her for that, and a breath of fresh air from that stupid Bienfu from Berseria, who was not funny but annoying of being a downgrade from Tipo from Exilia 1 and 2. So yeah, I like Patty, she is my second favorite female character in the game. Also, the skits are like how in Exilia 1 and 2, with just character portraits. Some skits are entertaining, funny, or emotional. That is all. Now, Tales of Vesperia is not just about story and characters, but also side quests, buying and upgrading items, exploring dungeons, which are better than Exilia 1 to Berseria's dungeon, and fast-paced real-time combat. The overworld of the game is classic, and I still love where the towns, dungeons, and other points of interest are located. Towns are where you can buy healing items, weapons, armors, and accessories, and hell, you can upgrade items and craft new ones with materials from defeated enemies and overworld, and even sleep at inns. Also, some towns have side quests where some of them are missable and can last from the first act of the game to the third act. Some quests reward you with titles, costumes, items, skills, and even arts. Now the dungeons, my god, Vesperia and Grisus, for the most part, has some of the most well-designed dungeons in the series with ruins, a ghost ship, forests, caves, a mountain, and even a snowfield. The corridor dungeons from Exilio 1 to Berseria were bland as hell with some exceptions, but Vesperia has by far the best dungeon designs in the series. The dungeons have some puzzles with block pushing or using the sorcerer's ring, which can also stun or piss off enemies. Now for the game's combat, which is an enhanced version of a battle system introduced in Tales of the Abyss. You have your 3-hit combo and free run for a 4th hit, and move around the battlefield, and even string arts together from base to arcane, altered, burst, and mystic art. However, Vesperia's version of Abyss's battle system has its own features. First off, the overlimit can be upgraded not just to level 4, but in the definitive and PS3 version can be upgraded to level 8, which means two characters can use their mystic arts. Fatal strikes are a new form of critical hit strike, which is activated when one of the fatal strike HP bar is 0 with specific art, which then you can use it when a color of blue, red, or green symbol appears for you to activate. Fatal strikes can insta-kill enemies, but not bosses, but can critical hit them. Some enemy types are weak, neutral, or resist a certain colored fatal strike. Now some arts aren't just obtainable via leveling up, but also via usage of certain arts or using one of the skills per characters. Now the skills are obtained when you have earned enough XP by specific weapon and sub-weapon, and also with certain combinations of skills you can get a glyph with a certain attribute during the overlimit mode. The combat system isn't perfect though Berseria or even Exilio 2 has my favorite battle system in the series, but it's a great battle system overall. Now this game has some amazing bosses, although some bosses have cheap tactics to make the fights annoying, and also combo one of your party members dead. Now let's talk about what else Definitive Edition brings other than two new playable characters, skits, subplots, and level 8 overlimit. Well, there are some obvious things like new arts, skills, weapons, side quests, and bosses, but there are also new dungeons like Sunken Grotto for side quests to fight the coolest optional boss, Sword Dancer, 3 times, a super long Necropolis of Nostalgia dungeon with an interesting backstory of Children of the Full Moon, Team Arena in the Colosseum, Arts Ball, an item for a total of 16 art shortcuts. All DLC are available from the previous versions like costumes and extra gold, a racing minigame for repeat, and an ability to refight bosses at Namco Bandai Isles. Also, Estelle vs. Estelle solo mirror match sounds the most sexiest thing in the game. There's a lot of stuff to talk about, but it would take hours for me to talk about, so let's move on over to the presentation. Now while the character models don't look as detailed as Exilio 1 to Berseria, they do have their charm and still looks great by today's standards. Also, the town and dungeon designs are better than in the more recent Tales games, and I hope future Tales games will take lessons from this game. Also, everything runs at 60 frames per second on both the PS4 and PC version, the Xbox One and Switch version in most areas run 60, but there are some dungeons and town where it will run 30, such as when camera pans, but in battles it runs at 60. The soundtrack is my favorite in the series thanks to the amazing Motoi Sakuraba, who makes damn good music in the series, even though I found Berseria's soundtrack forgettable in the series. Some of my favorites are The Daily Routine of a Shellfish Young Man, Furnace of War, Distorted Sword Light, Comfortable Journey, A Steering Taboo, Thousand Years Slumbering of the Blastia, Crossing the Small Hills, A Vow of Unity, In the Deep and Peaceful Brush, The Cold Morning Star Passes By, Best Overworld Theme in Video Games, Burning Fighting Spirit, Nightmare Reflected in the Mirror, A Formidable Foe Stands in the Way, which this version was used in Exilia 2, On the Other Side of the Mirage, The Wise One, The Tumultuous Mountain, Judith, A Portrait of Solitude, Soaring Over Day and Night, The Agents Float in the Sky, An Approaching Menace, The Savior's Determination, Tenacity, Echoing Breath, Fury Sparks, Moment of Ruin That Shakes the Heavens, Aim for the Top, and The Final Showdown. God damn, that's a lot of favorites I have in this game, which the whole soundtrack rivals the whole Final Fantasy franchise. Also, the theme song Ring a Bell is in this game in both English and Japanese, and to be honest, I like the English version more than the Japanese version. The PS3 and Definitive Edition adds more music like Restless Blade and Lost Memories, which are awesome boss themes, and there are other new music in this game. Now, the game comes with English and Japanese voices, although I stuck with English voices, and they still sound superb, although not every returning voice actor and actress returns to voice the unrecorded lines in the game. The cast features Troy Baker for the old lines, Adam Riegel, Julie Ann Taylor, Michelle Ruff, Joe Thomas, Allison Les Taylor, Sam Riegel, Kyle Habert, David Vincent, Keith Silverstein, Roger Craig Smith, Wendy Lee, DC Douglas, Bryce Peppenbrook, Megan Hollingshead, Keith Higgins, who voices Judith in this version, Jameson Price, Liam O'Brien, JB Blanc, Spike Spencer, and among others. New to this version is Grant George voicing Yuri's unvoiced lines, and Sandy Fox as Patty. Let's talk about Yuri's voice. Now, it was jarring to hear both Troy and Grant as Yuri, which sounded jarring, but I did get used to Grant's take on Yuri, and it does a damn good job, although I wish he voiced all Yuri's lines. It was jarring and inconsistent to hear at first, but it's not an issue for me anymore, although Matthew Mercer would have been another great choice. Now, hearing Kate voice Judith sounded kinda similar to Allison, but man, she sounded close, and really does a fantastic job, and I thought Velvet Crow's voice actress Christina V was gonna voice Judith at first. And now, Sandy Fox as Patty. I do remember hearing first time her voice as Asuka in Magic Knight Rayearth, but man, hearing Sandy as Patty is fitting. Now, this isn't the first time for her in the series, as she voiced Miyu in Tales of the Abyss, but it's impressive to hear Sandy voice a playable character. Also, I need to mention, it's amazing how Sam Riegel managed to make Kai Kisk in Guilty Gear Xrd Sign sound like Flame from this game, which is damn impressive. Overall, I still think the voice acting is superb. Now, the only issue I have is the audio mixing, which the problem is in some of the skits, which not every skit has the audio mixing problem, as most of them sound crystal clear. At least the audio mixing isn't as bad as Sonic Adventure games and Devil May Cry, which has the worst sound mixing. The audio mixing is a minor issue, which also is distracting. I'm unsure if this problem is in the Japanese voice option, but I still play with English voice option. Now, while this isn't that definitive, the Definitive Edition version of Tales of Vesperia is, in my opinion, the best version of the game on PC, PS4, Xbox One, and Nintendo Switch. The audio mixing is the only issue I have with this game, but everything else is superb. Exilia 2 since 2015 was my favorite in the series, but as of right now, Definitive Edition made Tales of Vesperia my all-time favorite in the series again. The extra story bits are nice, some new bosses are fun to fight, and even other new features are welcome that we never got to experience on the Japanese exclusive PS3 version. Also, I recommend Project Crosszone series for more Tales of Vesperia. Now, after this port, I want Namco to make a remake of a Tales game that was never released outside of Japan, a new main entry for both PC, PS4, and Nintendo Switch, or better yet, a new Tales fighting game made by developers of BlazBlue and Guilty Gear series and Dragon Ball FighterZ, Arc System Works. I would buy it if Arc System made it. I'm the Electro Kesanagi, and I would pick Yuri over Lloyd for Super Smash Bros. Ultimate.